Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. Thanks to Bernard. It's wonderful to be at the Y, and thanks to my friends at the Irish Arts Center. It's a great treat to do anything with my friend Lorrie. We go back. Don't we go back? I think we go back. She was 13, I was 53. I think it was something like that. I'm going to read you something from this book of stories. Let me be frank with you. It's four long stories narrated by Frank Bascombe, who narrated some other books that I wrote, which are set in New Jersey. And this book, these stories, are also set in New Jersey in 2012 in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy. And they are really about the consequences of Hurricane Sandy, those consequences that would be overlooked by CNN and Brian Williams. Though he was there. God love him, you know, you can't do anything wrong, can you, anymore? I mean, you do one thing wrong and you're just done. Where would any of us be, right? This story is called The New Normal. It's funny. I had to tell Terry Gross that. She kept talking to me and said, these stories are about death and they're about getting old. And I said, no, they're funny. Out the Haddam Great Road, just past 5, freezing rain has turned the blacktop into after-hours Dodgem cars. Only a few of us are braving it, our headlights glaring off the pavement like sheeny novas. A Ford Explorer, why is it always a Ford Explorer? Has already gone in the ditch, its driver waving me on with a shrug. A wrecker's on its way. Off in the trees on both sides, immense manorial houses twinkle through. Yuletide spruces, framed in picture windows, blaze outward, sharing Christmas cheer with the less moneyed. Years ago, I drove out here on just such a gloomy, wintry night to hand-deliver a $2 million full-price offer on a slant-roof, architect-designed monstrosity that's long since been torn down and calamitously hit a dog, precisely next door to the house I was hoping to sell. As with the Explorer, I went straight in the ditch, but clambered out, up, and across the black ice road to bring whatever helpless help I could to the poor wrecked beast who'd made a whomp when I hit it, boding ill. I, of course, feared it was my client's dog. There the poor thing lay in the ice-crusted grass in front of number 2605, breathing deep, rasping, not long for this world breaths. Its sorrowing eyes resigned and open to the snowy night, its last, not offering to move or even to notice me beside it on my knees, my cold hand on its hairy, hard ribs, feeling them rise and fall, rise and fall. It was a hound, a black and tan, somebody's old love bug, a wiggly crotch sniffer and shoe muncher bought for the kids, yet surviving on after they'd gone and now prime to be hit. What can I do for you, old Towser? I said these absurd words, knowing their answer. Nothing, thanks, you've done enough. After minutes, I hiked up to the house I was selling, shamefaced and in shock. I informed my clients what I'd terribly done. We all three walked down to the road in the snow, but the old boy had passed beyond us and was, because it was cold, grown stiff and peaceful and perfect. They didn't know whose dog it was. A hunter's strayed away in the night, they thought, though it was past the season for that. My clients, the Armentes, long since beyond life's pale themselves, felt a sorrow for me and my plight and let me go home with the promise to do something about the dog in the morning. I shouldn't worry. It was a terrible night to be out, which it was. In my realtor's memory, they accepted the offer following some testy back and forths with the young Bengali buyers. I often recollect such matters more positively than was true. It was a long time ago, 20 years at least. The dog, of course, lives on. I am on my pilgrim's way tonight, it is only 5:10, but could easily be midnight, to visit my former wife, Ann Dykstra, a resident now of the Beth Wessel wing at the community at Carnage Hill, a state-of-the-art staged care facility out here in what was once, when we were married 40 years ago, the verdant Haddam hinterlands. The community today borders a Robert Trent Jones faux links course, hidden from the road by a swatch of woods, the leaves now down. A birch bark canoe institute sits off to the left in deeper timber, its lights busily yellowing the snow flittery night. Other grand houses are semi-visible, accessible by gates with uniformed protection. Once it was possible to cast my eye over almost any piece of settled landscape here around and know how it would look in the future. What uses it'd be set to by succeeding waves of human purpose, as if a logic lay buried within the genome of its later what's it? Though out here now, all is frankly enigma. Probably it's my age, which explains more and more about me, like a master decryption code. In New Jersey, we've now built to the edge of the last 1,000,000 acres of remotely developable land. We're on track to use it up by mid-century. Property taxes are capped, but no one wants to sell, since no one wants to buy, all of which keeps prices high, but values low. My mission into the night's sinister weather 4 days before Christmas is to deliver to Anne a special yoga-approved, form-fitted, densely foamed and molded orthopedic pillow, which she can sleep on and that's recommended by neurologists in Switzerland to homeopathically treat Parkinson's, of which she's a new sufferer, by reducing stress levels associated with poor sleep, which themselves are associated with neck pain, which is associated with two vivid dreams, all associated with Parkinson's. Anne has resided in the Beth Wessel able-bodied independent wing since last June. She has her own two-bedroom feng shui-approved apartment, does her own cooking, drives her own focus, and has even acquired a boyfriend, a former Philadelphia cop named Buck. He has a last name, but I can't pronounce it since it's Polish. Buck's a large, dull piece of cordwood in his 70s, given to loose-fitting, permanently belted trousers, matching beige sweatshirts of the kind sold at Kmart, big glunker imitation suede shoes, and the thinnest of thin, pale hosiery. Somewhere, someone convinced Buck that a sculpted imperial and a pair of black horn-rimmed Dave Garraway specs would make him look less like a Polish meatball and make people take him more seriously, which probably never happens, though he's officially on record as handsome. He could pass as the good cop who genially interrogates the poor black kid from the projects until he suddenly loses his temper, bulges his eyes, balls up his horseshoe fists in the kid's face, and scares the shit out of him. Buck's carrying around a different John Grisham book every time I see him and refers to himself only as a first responder. I regularly encounter him lurking in the big public living room. He doesn't have enough to do with no robberies and home invasions to get his mitts into. He likes the idea that Anne, who he infuriatingly calls Miss Annie, that Anne and I go way back, which isn't quite the word for it, and that he and I share private, implicitly sexual understandings about her that men such as we are would never speak about, but that in the aggregate are special, possibly symbolic, and render us both lucky to have lived this long, foot soldiers in Miss Annie's army. Like me, Buck's a prostate survivor and has his personal talk. It is the sort that would drive Anne straight to the rafters. It includes his rank disdain for Viagra. No need for that junk. I prize my stiffy, let me tell you. The existence of a horse pill obtainable only online that makes us prostate guys piss like Percherons, thereby avoiding the men's room blues. Needless to say, he doesn't like Obama and blames him for shit-canning the American dream by creating a lost decade when it came to little people keeping up. He's a nice enough guy, meaning the president, but he really wasn't ready to assume the mantle. Bush, of course, was ready. And I'm convinced, spends time with him only to display for me the limitless variety of Homo sapiens who can easily fill my long empty shoes. Though why should affairs of his heart and hers be less inscrutable than the affairs of my own? It's not, however, the simplest of emotional transits to be driving out 4 days before Christmas to visit my ex-wife. We've been divorced 30 years in an extended care facility, suffering an incurable and fatal disease, and with whom I've not been all that friendly, but who's now a 20-minute drive away and somehow or other presenting issues. Relations end nowhere, as the poet said. How Ann Dykstra came to reside 20 minutes on my doorstep is a bittersweet tale of our time and should serve as cautionary if one's long ex-wife constitutes a demographic possible to comprehend and thus beware of. When Ann retired off the faculty of the Tocqueville Academy, she'd begun keeping time, but expecting nothing serious, with one of her de Tocqueville colleagues, the lumbering, swarthy-skinned, curly-haired ex-Harvard math quiz and whiz and lifelong mother's boy, Teddy Fuchs. Years before, Teddy had been headed for celestial math greatness, but had suffered a dissociative episode on the eve of his thesis defense on rectilinear quadratic equations and been banished to prep school teaching at Tocqueville, a not long drive from where his parents lived on the shore in Belmar. At Tocqueville, Teddy was regarded by all as profound and gentle and, what else, super bright, and as having this special connection with kids, which persuaded everybody that prep school teaching was his true métier, rather than being a chaired professor at Caltech with a clear shot at a Nobel, but possibly never being really, really happy like the rest of high school teachers. Teddy, at age 60, had never married, but had avoided the standard smirks and yorks and back-channel eye-rollings about his sexuality by being benign. There were no rumors of Greenwich Village adieu sightings or mysterious friends brought to faculty cookouts. Some people really are what they seem, though not that many. Teddy and Ann began seeing each other, began being a couple, taking trips, Turks and Caicos, Tel Aviv, the Black Sea port of Odessa, and speaking exclusively in terms of the other. I'll have to ask Ann about that. You know, back when Teddy was at Harvard, and as a tea time, Teddy wrote an influential paper about that in his junior year, which caused a lot of stir. These are mostly things she would never have said about me, since flogging suburban houses on cul-de-sacs that once were cornfields in West Windsor rarely get you noticed by the folks at the Stanford Linear Accelerator. I know any of this because our daughter, Clarissa Bascombe, now a veterinarian in Scottsdale, told me. Clarissa has always kept semi-taut lines with her mother, though much tauter with me and her brother. Back when it was all getting started with Teddy, Clarissa believed her mom could tolerate only a platonic relationship and that there was neither hanky nor panky afoot. That Teddy, though large, levantine, hairy, and apparently sensual, was in fact harmless and remote from his body. Lesbians think they know everything. And that after Anne's two marriages and two unsatisfactory men, one of them me, being with a man like Teddy, thoughtful, hopelessly reliable, obedient, occasionally mirthful, but not that much, no bad history with women, a good cook, and most important, Jewish, guaranteeing Clarissa believed no unwanted sexual advances, Teddy was all but perfect. Like most explanations, it's as plausible as anything else. Plus, Clarissa liked Teddy. I only met him once by accident. They had Harvard in common. And for all I know, sat up late nights singing the fucking songs. Long story short, it's never long enough. Never short enough. Anne retired, and so did Teddy, whose mother had conveniently died at age 90. Anne had dough from her second marriage. Teddy had his dead parents' 3,000-square-foot condo overlooking the sea in Belmar. A charmed coming together, it seemed, was forged for both parties, an acquaintance that hesitantly blossomed into something more instead of the usual less. a mutually acknowledged, if somewhat not fully shared, sense of life's being better when not spent dismally alone, a willingness to try to take an interest in the other. Learn golf, learn calculus, plus the condo. Ann and Teddy sent around at-home announcements. One actually came to me, declaring the uniting of all our assets, real, spiritual, and virtual. I took note, but not serious note. As far as I was concerned, Ann had simply embarked on another new course in life, the main source of interest and primary selling point of which was that it carried her further away from being my wife and nearer to becoming just another person I might never have known, whose obituary my eye might pass over without the slightest pause or twinge, which is the goal and most perfect paradigm of what we mean when we say divorce. Though, of course, that's crazy. The kids see to it, as does memory, which, short of Alzheimer's, never lets you off the mat. Following which, and after 4 years of landing on glaciers in minuscule airplanes, walking the Via Dolorosa barefoot, 2 trips to the Masters, a lifelong dream of Anne's, backcountry trips to the Maghreb, plus any number of books on tape, videos of Harvard lectures on neuroplasticity, trips to Chautauqua to hear washed-up writers squawk about what it's like to be them, plus 4 visits to Mayo to keep up with heart anomalies, Teddy believed he'd inherited from his Harvard experience. Following all that, Teddy simply died one morning while sitting an oversized baby in the Atlantic surf wearing pink bathing trunks. An aneurysm. Dead at 64, as Paul Harvey used to say. Anne, who was on the 10th floor balcony watching him with pleasure, saw him topple over face into the sea. She thought he was playing a joke and laughed and waited for him to right himself. He had a comic side. Anne lived on in the condo after Teddy's death. I had no idea what she did or how she did it. Mom's fine was the most Clarissa would allow, as if I was not to know. Paul Bascombe, our son, an unusual man apart on his best day and now happily running a garden supply in Kansas City, maintains only a distant fondness for his mother and so had nothing to inform me about her. But complications and unfathomables in dealing with one or another aging parent seem now to be the norm for modern offspring. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. It's really sort of a nightmare to read after Richard, but it's also a great privilege. I'm going to read from a story called Wings, which is about two struggling musicians. I'm just going to start from the beginning. The grumblings of their stomachs were intertwined and unassignable. Was that you or was that me, she would ask in bed, and Dench would say, I'm not sure. They lay there in the mornings, their legs moving at angles toward one another, not unlike the elms she could see through the window outside, the high branches nuzzling in the late March breeze, speaking tree to tree of the thrilling weather. Her dreams of eating meals full of meat, which caused her teeth to gnash in the night, surely a sign of spring, left the insides of her cheeks bloody and chewed, one saliva gland now swelled to the size of a raisin. That's a sign your career's not doing that well. so that's what this story's about. Shouldn't they be up and about already? Morning sun shot across the ceiling in a white stripe of paint. She and Dench were both too young and too old for this close, late morning, bed-bound life, but their scuttled careers, the band, the two CDs, the newsletter turned e-letter, turned abandoned cyber litter, on how to simplify your life, be broke. The driving, the touring, the scrambling, the foraging in parks for chives and dandelions, the charging up of credit cards, the taking pictures of clothes and selling them on eBay. Wake up, she used to exclaimed to him in the middle of the night, sitting up in bed, wake up and listen to my ideas. All this had led them here to a 9-month sublet that allowed pets. Still in their 30s, but barely, they had bought themselves a little time. So what if her investments these days were in pennies, wine corks, and sheets of self-adhesive forever stamps? These would go up in value, unlike everything else. Beneath her bed was a shoebox of dwindling cash from their last gig, where they'd gotten only a quarter of the door. She could always cut her long, almost Asian hair again, as she had 2 years ago, and sell it for $1,000. Now, as she often did when contemplating wrong turns, she sometimes thought back to when it was she had first laid eyes on Dench, that Friday long ago when he had approached her at an afternoon sound check in some downtown or other, his undulating tresses not product-free, a demeanor of arrangement and premeditation that gussied up something more chaotic. Although it was winter, he wore mirrored sunglasses and a thin leather jacket with the collar turned up. 150% jerk. Perhaps it was his strategy to improve people's opinions of him right away, to catch an upward momentum and make it sail. So when the sunglasses came off and then the jacket, and he began to play a song he had not written himself, he was on his way. He lunged onto one knee and raced through a bludgeoning bass solo. At the drums, he pressed the stick into the cymbal and circled it, making a high-pitched celestial note like a finger going round the edge of a wine glass. He smacked the tambourine against his head and against the snare, back and forth. When he approached the piano, she stopped him. "Not the piano," she said quietly. "The piano's mine." "Okay," he said. "I just wanted to show you everything I can do." And he picked up an acoustic guitar. Would it be impossible not to love him? Would not wisdom intervene? Later, to the rest of the band, when skepticism toward Dench was edged with polite dismay, she said, "I don't understand why the phrase, like an orchestra tuning up, is considered a criticism. I love an orchestra when it is tuning up, especially then." From the beginning, however, she could not see how Dench had ever earned a living. He knew 2 Ryan Adams songs and played guitar fairly well, but he had never done so professionally or done anything professionally that she could discern. Early on, he claimed to be waiting for money, and she wasn't sure when he smiled whether this was a joke. "From whom? Your mother?" she asked, and he only smiled, which made her think, yes, indeed, his mother. But no, his mother had died when he was a teenager. His father had disappeared years before that, and thereafter for Dench there was much moving with his sisters from Ohio to Indiana to California and back, first with his mom, then with an aunt. There was apparently in his life a lot of dropping in and out of college and unexplained years. There had been a foreshortened stint in the Peace Corps in Swaziland. "I'd just be waiting on a village bus stop, reading a book, and women would pretend to want to borrow it to read, but in truth, they just wanted a few pages for toilet paper," he said. "Or the guys they had me working with, they would stick their hands in the porta potties as soon as we got them off the truck. They just wanted the fragrant blue palms. I had to get out of there, man. I didn't really understand the commitment I had made, and so my uncle got a congressman to pull some strings." How did Dench pay his bills? "It's one big magic trick," he said. He liked to get high before dinner and seemed never without a joint in his wallet or in a drawer. He ate his chicken, the wings and the drumsticks, the arms and the legs, clean down to the purple bones. And so, though she could not tell an avocado plant from flax, he had both. And though she had never seen any grow lights or seeds or a framed license to grow medical marijuana from the state of Michigan, Casey began to fear Dench made his living by selling pot. It seemed to be the thing he was musing about and not saying. As she had continued to see him, she suspected it more deeply. He played her more songs. Then as something caught fire between them and love secured its footing inside her, when she woke up next to him with damp knots in the back of her hair like she'd never experienced before, the room full of the previous night's candles and the whiff of weed, his skin beside her, a silky calico of cool and warm, and as they both needed to eat and eat some more together, she began to feel okay that he sold drugs. If he did, what the hell? At least there was that. At least he did something. His sleepy smiles and the occasional flash of a euro or a $100 bill in his pocket seemed to confirm it, but then his intermittent lack of cash altogether perpetuated the mystery, as did his checks, which read D. Encher, and she started to fear he might not sell drugs after all. When she asked him straight out, he said only, "You're funny." And after she had paid for too many of his drinks and meals, since he said he was strapped that week and then the week after that, she began to wish a little sheepishly that he did sell drugs. Soon she began to hope deeply that he did. Once she even prayed for him to do so. And soon she was close to begging. Just a little skunk, darling, just a little pocket rocket, just a bit of wake and bake. Instead, he joined her band. The band had been called Villa, and in the end it had not worked out. Tours they paid for themselves with small business loans. Audiences who did not like Casey's own songs. Two singer-songwriter with rhymes, calories, and galleries that she was foolishly proud of, dead and wed, including one tune she refused to part with since it had briefly been positioned to be a minor indie hit, a song about a chef in New Jersey named Jim Barber, with whom she'd once been in love. "Here I am, your unshaved fennel. Here I am, your unshaved cheese. All I want to know is when I'll feel your blade against my knees." Its terribleness eluded her. Her lyrics weren't sly or hip or smoky and tough, but the demure and simple hopes of a mouse. She'd spent a decade barking up the wrong tree as a mouse. Audiences booed, the boys in their red-framed spectacles, the girls in their crooked little dresses. Despised especially were her hip-hop renditions of Billy Joel and Neil Young. She was once asked to please sing "Down by the River," and she'd thought they'd meant the song. She told this sad joke over and over. Throughout the band tour, she would wake up weeping at the edge of some bed or other, not knowing where she was or what she was supposed to do that day, or once or twice even who she was, since all her endeavor seemed separate from herself, a suit to slip into. Tears, she had once been told, were designed to eliminate toxins, and they poured down her face and slimed her neck and gathered in the recesses of her collarbones, and she had to be careful never to lie back and let them get into her ears, which might cause the toxins to return and start over. Of course, the rumor of toxins turned out not to be true. Tears were quite pure, and so the reason for them, it seemed to her later when she thought about it, was to identify the weak, so that the world could assure its strong future by beating the weak to death. "Are we perhaps unlovable?" she asked Dench. "It's because we're not named like Birth Hearse for Dog Face. why aren't we named that? Because we have standards, he said. Is that it? She said, yeah, and not just body and soul as an encore, though we do that well. I mean, we maintain a kind of integrity. Integrity, really, she said. After too many stolen meals from mini bars, the Pringles can carefully emptied and the foil top resealed, the container replaced as if untouched back atop the wood tray, hotel towels along with the gear all packed up in the rental truck whose rear fender bore one large bumper sticker with Donald Rumsfeld's visage under which read, "Does this ass make my truck look big?" After all that, she continually found herself thinking, if only Dench sold drugs. On hot summer days, she would find a high-end supermarket and not only eat the free samples in their tiny white cups, but stand before the produce section and wait for the vegetable misters to come on, holding her arms beneath the water in relief. She was showering with the lettuces. She and Dench had not developed their talents sufficiently, nor cared for them properly, or so a booking agent told them. Dench took offense. You forget about the prize perplexity, he said, the award angle. They are often looking for people just like us, and we could win something, he exclaimed, with Pringles in his teeth. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Are our microphones working? They're now on.
Are they?
Yeah, they are now.
They're on now.
It's magic.
Yeah, it's magic.
The writers were concerned that they'd go to the bathroom and you'd hear that.
You're revealing the secret talk of the green room, Bernard.
We'll never let you do this again.
Well, I didn't intend to do it tonight, but Lori said somebody had to ask the questions. And so I'll ask a few, and then we'll open it up to you all. The mics are just at the bottom of each aisle. We'll bring the lights up. It's rare that we have writers together who, as Richard said, go way back. And I wanted to ask, if you recall, not the first time that you met, but the first time you encountered a Richard Ford or a Lorrie Moore piece of writing. And maybe I'll ask Lorrie first.
I think Richard's editor sent me the sports writer. I do think that was the first that I read of yours, and I was blown away by it. I just loved it. I think I blurbed it. I think he was looking for a woman to blurb it, and then the book just did so well that he took my name right off of it. Because it's, you know, people would pick it up and go, who's Lorrie Moore? Like, what? So it was, there is a printing that has a mark from me. But then it went,
do you remember what you said?
I said something like, I don't know. It's something like, this is fantastic.
And I remember the first story of Lorrie's that I read, because I used to teach it. It was You're Ugly Too, which is a wonderful, wonderful, funny, and sort of riveting and mordant story about, I won't tell you what it's about, but it's about life in New York. It's what it's about, and it's wonderful, and I think of it all the time. It's certainly not it was the first story of hers that I read, and I think I anthologized it. I'm sure
you put it in. Yeah, you were very nice. Yeah. You put it in the Best American Short Story.
Did I? Well, good for me. I'm glad I was that smart then. But then I put it in other things too. Such a great story. But it's certainly not the last great story of yours that I have read, and they go on and on. So yeah, I think I have a very precise memory of when I first encountered Lorrie. We were sort of in New York together at the same time, and we don't know when.
80s. We were trying to come up with a. There's a dinner we both remember very vividly, but we hadn't met before. But it was a dinner we had with Harold Brodkey.
Yeah.
When Brodkey was alive.
I remember very well that dinner because we stayed up in Harold's house in Ellen Schwamm, his wife or whatever they were together. They were together. And we had a good time, and we were all staying in the room, and then we got late for our reservation, and so we got down to the restaurant, which was basically below where we were staying, where they lived, and our reservation was gone, and they completely flipped, and I thought, God, this is how it is to be in New York. If you're five minutes late for your restaurant reservation, they give it to somebody else, and then you don't get to eat that night, and everybody's deeply pissed off about it. And Lorrie and I was kind of looking at each other, sort of two bumpkins from someplace else, and we thought, oh, gee, this is how it is.
Yeah, well, it was the 80s. No Southern graciousness
I'm curious to know if you still feel like bumpkins, or if when you come back to New York, you teach in New York nowadays, it feels more like a home away from home.
And to me, it'll never be a home. I mean, it's always just this monolith that I occasionally sort of go in and go out of. No, I really like the territories. I don't really much care about the city. I understand what the city's about. I understand what it's worth. My wife teaches at Columbia, and she's an urban planner. So I've had a snoot full of urban for many, many years. For 47 years, I've had urban, but we both really, I think now, particularly me, prefer the country.
You were saying in the meeting with the school kids that. You're both kind of obsessive note takers. That's part of your process. And I'm curious if you could talk about that, maybe in reference to the excerpts that you read tonight, if we could talk, since the audience has just heard from them, how those stories got made. Maybe, Laura, you could start.
You know, it's the weird thing about note-taking is, you know, once it's folded into the narrative, you kind of forget
really
where they come. You
it's really
forget
true.
The origins of it. And when you go back over old notebooks, I used to say to people, especially when you get a little older, it's important, and I love this word, it's important to check off. To check off your note, because you may forget that you've used it, and you might
put it in again.
You might put it in someplace else,
or in the same story.
Who knows? Hopefully not the same story, but you know, you get older, you forget. You know, as I told you, I forgot that one thing that I'd included in the story. So you forget, you know. But if you cross things out as you use them, then you know that, you know, that's gone and done. But a lot of things you don't use, you collect a lot of things, and you just don't find places for them. They just don't fit in, and sometimes you can't read your own handwriting. There's always that. But it's a little bit probably how poets work, you know. You collect, and it's how it would be like being a photographer, except you're a writer. So you're going out in the world. Thoughts occur to you, write them down, but also things that you see. You write down, you're just collecting it all, and you're putting it in language rather than, you know, taking a picture with your cell phone, which is what happens now.
And also, when you write things down, and wherever you put them, you collect them somewhere in a notebook or envelope, and then over the course of time. You return to them and you winnow them out. So some things that you wrote down that you thought were interesting are not. They're boring, and so you throw them out.
Yeah.
So that when you finally get to the point at which you are ready to write a story or a novel, even, you look at those things and they hold up. And what then they represent is the most important things you know. And that causes the work, the story that you then write, the novel that you write, to represent and to contain the most important things you know. And that's, for me anyway, terrifically important, because in the vicissitudes of writing a long book, you're constantly running into shoaly ground And you, if you're always, however, writing about something important, well, then that buoys you in a way. I mean, then that little passage that I read about that dog. Christina and I were driving from Oxford, Mississippi to Taylor, Mississippi one night about 4 years ago, and the car in front of me hit a dog. And the dog just went, it was about 9 o'clock at night, and the dog went tumbling over into the ditch. And I don't think the car, or the driver even knew he'd hit a dog, or if he did, typical of Mississippians, he didn't give a shit. And so I, however, did. So I got out of the car, and I went over into the ditch, and I got down on my hands and knees, and I got my face down by this big dog's face, and he was, or it was, he was, she was, alive, but completely in shock. Mm. And I just got down, and I put my hands on the dog's chest, and it was breathing, and it was breathing, and it was breathing, and then it died. Right in my hands, basically, and so I thought, as we do, you know, I thought, well, this is something I have to remember. I don't want to forget that, and so I wrote it down. I got back to the house that night and I wrote it down, and then when I started writing that story, here comes that little passage ready, and so I stuck it in there, and it fits. I mean, you know, Ruskin says that. Composition is the arrangement of unequal things, and that was an unequal thing that I patched into that story.
Updike has a dying cat story
too. Yeah,
yeah, it's a very complicated moment that's obviously, you know, put in from something he observed elsewhere, but he made it fit in a very collage-y kind of way, to use the scientific term.
I sometimes think that writing stories is championing your own response to things. And
right, and your sensibility, your observations, and, you know, paying respect and witness to the world as you've encountered it and being true to that.
Right, and not worrying about whether it's appropriate or inappropriate. I remember Seamus one time, I was at the Abbey, and Seamus got up in front of the audience and he said, I'm going to read a poem, he said, which champions the subjective. He said, I think there should be more championing of the subjective. And it's a typical thing for him to have said. But that's just true. I mean, we so diminish the value of the subjective, as if somehow what I think and what I experience and what I believe and what I sense are only valuable if it's appropriate. It's only valuable if it somehow, you know, meets the test of everybody's opinion. But if that's the case, all richness goes out of life.
I'm interested in what you say about the subjective in relation to the idea that you have written now 4 books with the Frank Bascombe character. Where does your subjective interact with his subjective?
As little as possible, really. I know Lorrie and I agree about this. We're not writing about ourselves, and we're better off when we're writing about something that ourselves are interested in, but that may not in any way represent ourselves.
Right.
Yeah. So if I ever agree with something that I have Frank Bascombe think, I think, what's wrong with you? Is this as good as you can do? Come on, dig a little deeper. Have him think something that you don't agree with. And that's good, because it makes him be, he will say things that I would never necessarily think or say. And that's good, because as Lorrie said when we were talking to these young students today, it's free in a piece of fiction, it's unguarded, but it's defended at the same time,
and it's costumed.
Yes,
and the names are changed,
right.
And you can just have fun. I mean, that, you know, I was trying to instill a sense of fun in them, because it is fun to do this.
Well,
to do what we do.
Sometimes it is fun, sometimes it's fun.
I think it's fun.
Frost said that, he's talking about poetry, he said, poetry is the last vestige of our childhood. We must deal with it somewhat irresponsibly.
Yeah. Speaking of fun, I mean, you all make these stories on your own at your desks, and the response you get from a live audience. You send your books out into the world and readers read them, but you don't hear them laughing. And I wonder if when you bring it to a house like this, you feel like they're laughing in the right places or sighing in the right places. Or if you have an idea of a reader's or an audience's response as you're creating the work, or is it?
No, I don't have that at all. I mean, you sort of discover when you read things aloud what some people will respond to, but once you're on a stage and you're in performance mode, which is not really what we do for a living, but we're asked to do it. But so once you become a performer, you become like every performer, where you say, well, the audiences in St. Louis were pretty bad, or like, they were fabulous in Chicago, or I killed them in Ann Arbor. You know, I mean, you start to sort of notice the differences. Like, the lights are low, so I don't even know. I have had experiences where I have thought more people were laughing than were. And when the lights came up, I've had experiences too where the lights have come up and it's just like a sea of empty seats. So I don't know, they may have left in the middle, I don't know. But the whole navigation of a stage, an audience, this is not really what writers do, but we're asked to do it. And it's interesting, it's the opposite of sitting at a desk and writing, to me. It seems very opposite of it. And in that way, it's sort of interesting.
But it also brings us into affiliation with the people who we are actually writing for, to other human beings. I mean, I wouldn't be writing books if somebody didn't read them. I'm quite certain of that, you know.
I would.
Would you? Well, I definitely would not.
I would like people to buy my books and never read them. So that's kind of tricky. But I used to say, keep the shrink wrap right on. Don't take it off. But, you know.
There's a line of Cyril Connolly's, which is in the Unquiet Grave. And Connolly says, very orotund, he says, it is better to have a self and no public than to have a public and no self. And I think, horseshit. I happily dedicate myself and immolate myself.
Really?
Oh, absolutely, in a heartbeat, believe me. I got into this racket reading books, and if ain't nobody gonna read my books, I ain't gonna make them. Because it's they're more fun things to do.
That's interesting. I mean, you both have quite a bit of experience teaching.
Yeah.
And I'm curious to know that there's the writing self, there's the performance self, and then there's who you are in the classroom. Lorrie is telling her students it's fun and it's like make-believe, and you're saying if nobody's reading your books, you need to quit and go do something else. No, I'm curious though, I think it was especially interesting when Jack Leggett died a couple of weeks ago,
yeah,
who had run the Iowa Writers' Workshop in the 70s and 80s.
Well, neither of us went, so we're innocent
didn't.
Of that.
But it said in the Times that when he was running the workshop, there were 15 MFA programs, and now there's several hundred. And
I think there's 700, actually.
Really?
I think something really strange. When I was in graduate school in 1980, there were 75 programs. And my memory is that there's now a zero on that. There's 750 writing programs. That's a lot.
I'm curious, though. I mean, meeting your readership in a forum like this is one thing. But if you could talk about how do you interact with your students? You've both been at it for an incredibly long time and came through.
No, we haven't been at it for an incredibly long time at all.
But we've watched them become, I mean, different generations have come through.
Is it different now?
Oh, it is very different now. Don't you
think? I don't know. I don't teach creative writing, so I don't know what it is, what's going on in there.
What do you teach?
Literature. The other thing.
Well, I teach literature in the creative writing context, but I am reading their work and assigning things for them to read. But But
how is it different?
The same, you know, you just are acquainted with a new generation of kids. And so, you know, 20-year-olds right now are both the same and different from 20-year-olds 30 years ago. Do the math on that, 20 years ago.
But you want to be also your best self, in the sense that you love literature, you wouldn't be there. You're not cynical about its efficacies. And so what you want to do is to be its endorser and its spokesman. I mean, another thing Cyril Connolly said, which was right, was that the only proper function for a writer is to write a masterpiece. And if you're not going to write a masterpiece,
right.
If you don't want to write a masterpiece, then go back to Dubuque, you know? I mean, so it's not hard to be an advocate.
Dubuque is actually a pretty hot town right now.
Well, I'll trust you on that one.
I'm close enough to it. It's right on the Mississippi. It's got really great loft spaces. There are a lot of painters and writers are moving there.
Well, we should all go there then.
Just saying. But you're into real estate, so I'm just saying.
I am into real estate.
There's some good real estate in Dubuque.
But it's not hard to be an advocate for literature, for its most important duties and responsibilities in our lives, and to try to set the bar high for people. I mean, if you don't sort of fundamentally believe that this is a viable vocation, you probably shouldn't be doing it. And it's actually, I tell my students, I'm only with them 2 hours a week, but I tell them the happiest I am in the week is when I'm in the room with them.
I know, I love being in the room with, it's yeah. The reward for teaching,
yeah,
really, being in the room with them. They're so interesting and lively and fun people. It's really like a reward for everything else, a reward for reading their work. Oops! No, I love them. But I do feel that even if it's not a viable vocation, that it's viable. It's a viable education. These are the future readers. We want to create future readers. We want to create future appreciators. We also want to create future reviewers. I mean, some of these kids, even when they're not great writers, are very astute readers. And if you encourage them along that way, I mean, this is going to be helpful for the literary conversation of the future, I hope.
I think that's true. I think that's true.
Speaking of appreciators, why don't we open it to the audience, and if we could bring the lights up. If anybody has a question, there are mics down either end. Don't be shy.
This is where we get to see all the empty seats.
That's okay. I'm happy. I'm happy that there are people.
Yeah, I know.
Could you people tell us about your editing process?
I'm assuming you mean sort of self-editing as opposed to a relationship with an editor. It happens as I go along, and then also happens later, and it's sort of ongoing. And I've actually even made changes between the hardcover and the paperback, you know, because there suddenly can be a word you think, oh, that's so terrible. I've gone into bookstores even after the paperback has come out, and you know, then it's too late, and you just kind of cross it out. But I sign it, and I say self-corrected by the author. So, you know, it's ongoing. Hopefully, at some point, it stops. To edit myself, I should say, it is to be hoped that at some point it would stop. Many times, over. And sometimes you take things out, sometimes you put the very same thing back in. You're trying to get the voice, the sentence, everything right. Every work of fiction has its own voice. It owes a lot to your voice and your mind and how you think of stories, but it also has its individual one, and you're trying to get it right. It's hard. Go ahead.
Oh, you're just trying to get every word in the right place. That's all. I mean, and whatever it takes to do that, you just keep on doing it. I read all my books aloud to my wife, And it takes a month or 5 weeks, all day, every day, to read them aloud. But I'm dyslexic, and so it's hard for me to get the words in the right place because they move around and they go wrong in all kinds of queer ways. And so it requires me to read them aloud, unless I can read something aloud. And that has its own liabilities involved in it. But I mean, it's just, you know, what you, irrespective of how you go about doing it, the idea is that you have to authorize everything. You have to authorize every period, every dash, every word choice, where this ends and where that begins. And that's what authorship actually is. So you just keep on doing it until you can't do it anymore. And what Lorrie said about sometimes you find yourself putting something back into a sentence that you've taken out earlier, that's kind of, for me, the test when I've done all I know how to do, when I'm putting words back as they were before and had taken them out previously, then I think I'm saturated at that point. But it's just part of the deal. To me, it's the only part of writing books that I really, truly, deeply loathe.
Editing?
Joyce says that's the part she likes. Joyce Carol Oates, and our friends, and she said that's the part she loves. And I think, oh, what's wrong with you? How can you love that part? But she does, and I don't. I'm just
deeply... Oh, you said loathe, not
loathe. Loathe. She loathed it. She loves it. I loathe it.
You loathe it.
She loves it. She loves the part when she's niggling around with words and getting, you know, the clock is ticking and she's getting closer to the end and she likes that. I don't like that. Because I don't like about it is that I'm constantly bumping up against my own infelicities and my own, you know, boneheadedness and things that aren't right and that will never be right enough. So, I mean, I don't want to make this seem like it's hard. I don't believe it is hard. Other things are hard, but this is tedious.
But you do feel you're improving it when
you
edit
it. Yeah, you do. You have to feel
it. But then you have to look at it again the next day to see if that's actual.
Yeah.
You know.
Right.
So,
you do.
Because sometimes you haven't.
Did everybody go away?
Who they was went alive? Away.
Well, you just decide. What the hell? I'm standing in line all day to get a bagel.
I think there's another gentleman here.
Hello. I have actually a question for Mr. Ford, but
yes, sir.
Lorrie could also chime in on it. I've been reading your works over the years, and I've noticed just reading stories, especially thinking of a story like Empire, that obviously a lot of your male characters, there's a lot of affairs going on, obviously, and I've just noticed
sex, and love, and things like that. Yeah.
And I've noticed that
it's great.
Yeah, a lot of times when this occurs, the character is jobless. And I feel like there's some relation between committing an affair and joblessness and grating against capitalism and I almost a courage in that, in the committing the affair and not working and not sitting in that position. And I was just wondering if that was something you were conscious of.
This is not a question, by the way.
It's getting there.
This is more of a statement.
He's wondering if you have noticed that too.
I've never noticed that. You try to put drama, human drama, into your stories wherever you can find them. And there's a wonderful line of Mavis Gallant's who said, "If we knew what went on between women and men, we wouldn't need literature." And so I always think, you know, whatever women and men do together in a room alone is interesting. It can be made interesting because that attracts our attention, because someplace in our little remote interiors, there is that paradigmatic human situation. And so that's all, irrespective of what they're doing, and mostly they're not screwing, mostly what they're doing is talking and feeling and reacting. And so that's just me looking for drama, really. I mean, you put two people in a room together, you gotta get them to do something. But I don't know what it has to do with, in my It's interesting, though, what it has to do with joblessness, because for me, what a character does for a living, how he or she earns his keep, is kind of essential for my feeling that character is plausible. So for me to have characters, and you're right that I do sometimes have characters that don't have jobs, means that they are in a kind of spiritual nowhere, a kind of spiritual limbo. And it may just be that affiliation with another is the affiliation that stands for a more substantive one. So thank you.
Lorrie, do you want to?
I don't think you need.
Oh, that was for him. That wasn't a question.
Chiming in about capitalism and transgression.
Oh no, I think there's another question.
I think it's this.
Oh, I'm
go to
sorry.
This one.
Hi. Thanks so much. I'm a big fan of both of yours. This is a question from Mr. Ford. The Frank Bascombe books are often mentioned in the same breath as the rabbit books.
Yeah.
And angstrom is not a common word, but I actually just began Lay of the Land, and I was surprised to find the word angstrom in the first chapter, and I was wondering, is that a coincidence or a little bit of a...
It is a coincidence, but an angstrom, and I don't know what John, I always thought John called rabbit angstrom because of the angst insinuation. But an angstrom is actually a measure in dentistry of something smaller than a centimeter, and one angstrom or two angstrom is. Angstroms is the way that dentists measure how much enamel you have on your teeth after you've ground them down for 60 years. And so that got into my book that way and that way only, I promise. I promise.
When you used it, were you thinking, oh, some people might think of...
No, I didn't ever think that. I didn't ever think that. I mean, I'm perfectly capable of doing something like that as an homage, if I had felt the need at that point to do that. But it was totally isolated in that particular sentence. I've thought about it since then, though. You mentioned it, and I've thought about it myself. But it was in there totally coincidentally. If you believe that there are such things as coincidences, and I'm sure if there are any literary critics in the audience, you're all laughing at us and saying there are no such things as coincidences.
Well, I noticed it too. I noticed angstrom in Lay of the Land.
I'm guilty as charged.
No, I thought it was very typical.
But I would happily do that because I'm very respectful of John and respectful of those books, absolutely.
Well, I'll go back through the rabbit books and look for Bascombe, and I'll let
you
know.
You may not find them. You may not find them.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. This question is for both of you. A few days ago, there was big news in American fiction. We learned that celebrated one-hit wonder, Harper Lee, is going to be giving us another book written in the 50s before To Kill a Mockingbird and detailing the adventures of Scout Finch as an adult in the years after the years we read about in To Kill a Mockingbird. Since you're both major voices in American fiction yourselves, I wonder if you could tell me whether you regard this development more with excitement, with indifference, or with trepidation.
Since Richard's publisher is backstage, and Harper Lee's publisher, I'm going to let you go.
I will only say that I will read it. What else can you do? I mean, it's a book you haven't read. How dare you feel anything about it at all, except anticipation and sort of enthusiasm.
It could be very good.
It could be great. It could be terrific. There's certainly nothing to make me think that it won't be good. And I certainly don't have any trepidation about it. I don't have any skepticism about it. You just, like every other book, open it and read the first sentence. I did write my friend Jeff Brown, who's on the NewsHour, and he was the first person who told me about this. I said, why wouldn't you quit while you were ahead? But clearly she's ready to do this, and so good for her. I mean, you read To Kill a Mockingbird, and this is the book that she wrote before that, you have to think it probably has some considerable reader's merit. I wouldn't be, as again, I wouldn't be skeptical of it. Thank you.
Hi. I was wondering, how do both of you organize your notes?
Organize
notes. Organize, like a filing cabinet or Ziplocs?
I have a bunch of little notebooks. I once went into my son's first grade class, and I, to sort of talk about the writer's life, and I thought, what am I going to say to a bunch of first graders? But I took a big shopping bag and I put all my old notebooks in there and went into the class and stuck them down, and we pulled them out and we looked at them, and of course they were very boring to the first graders. The first graders were actually much more interested in the finished books, which I also brought. I said, here's how I started and here's how I finished. And they were much more interested in asking how I had gotten all the letters in a straight line. They were really amazed. I said, it's hard work. But, you know, it was hard, but I did it. So it's kind of chaotic, the notebooks thing. And sometimes I actually, now that I've gotten over my fear of computers, I'm on my laptop and I keep notes in files. Do you do that?
I do something similar.
Yeah, notes in files on the desktop of my laptop.
The chaos is the best part, really, to be immersed in all of this superfluity of stuff is actually quite consoling and enriching in a way. You don't know what's going to come of it, and you don't know how you're going to begin to find the sort of ligatures among all of these things. But to be just sort of suffused in all the stuff that you've written down is actually quite pleasurable. It's sort of like confetti in a way. You just sort of throw it up and let it come around you. But at some point, though, you, at least in my life, you have to take those little things, and I know Lorrie writes things on Post-its, and I write things on Post-its, and I write things on napkins, and then write things all over the place, and in a little notebook that I carry with me. But at some point, you just have to kind of sit down and type it up.
Yeah.
Just get one notebook after one note after the next and type it up on a computer or a typewriter or whatever. And then you see really what you've got. And in the process of typing things up off of your rudimentary notes, at least in that case, it's true of me, you begin to sort of see what the lineaments of a story might be.
Right.
That's something that might go at the beginning.
Right.
Well, that's a line that sounds like the end of something.
Well, I sometimes do that. I write ending or beginning, middle.
Me too.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And sometimes I'm right and sometimes I'm wrong, but I think of it already
something,
in terms of a play.
Things sound like the end.
Right.
Or things sound like, and what you're really reacting to is the sort of sonority of the line as you wrote it in your note. And you type it directly, specifically out of your note onto the page, and that sonority is sometimes very helpful to you, or to me anyway, to say, well, this is what this should sound like. This is what this book should sound. It should sound like that.
Right.
Not like that, but like that.
Right.
And it's discovery, and it's actually... Right.
Getting the sound of the book is...
Yeah, it's a lot.
Everything.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's a good place to end.
We have one more.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have one more.
Please, we don't want to exclude you.
Hi. I was wondering, when you actually start writing the short story, do you usually know where you're going and how it's going to end when you first start?
I have a rough idea, but it's usually pretty rough. And as I've said before, when asked this question, I often jump ahead and write the ending, and sometimes pulling from notes, because I can suddenly see what the ending should be. And short stories are they're very end-oriented forms. Mm. It's not even a form, it's a genre. But the end tells you really what the story is about and what its true meaning is. The end tells you that much more than a novel. a novel can end in any number of ways, but the end of a story is very key. So I sometimes jump ahead, do the ending, so I can see what the story is about, what I'm assembling. And then I might tinker with it, and you know, it's a mix of things, but the ending is the ending comes in somewhere before I actually get there. That's how I work.
Me too. More or less, although I usually don't change things much at the end. If I think I know the ending, then I usually try to aim at it.
Yeah, I try to aim, and sometimes I miss. It's like parallel parking. It's like,
it's true about novels versus stories. If a short story has the wrong end, it's not a short story, it's nothing. Whereas if a novel has the wrong end, it's still a novel.
There are some great novels with bad endings.
Yeah, there's some great novels with bad all kinds of stuff. I mean, Tender as the Night is a great novel that has completely bollocked structure.
Yeah.
But I remember when I was writing Independence Day, I wrote the end, which was the end I'd planned. When I wrote it, I didn't like it very much. I thought, well, it's okay. It's what I thought I would write. And okay, there it is. So I turned it in, and everything was Jake. But about 3 weeks before the book was about to be set, I said, I'm going to read this passage again. I don't like this very much. And so I read it again, and I thought, oh, no, this is wrong. I can do better than that. So I sat down, and I recast it. I didn't rewrite it. I recast it, just made it be different. And I told my friends at Knopf that I had written a different ending, and they just said, no, you can't do that. You can't write a new ending for this book. The ending is the way you wrote it. This, we like it. I said, no. I like this ending better, and I'm going to write another ending. This is it. So I did it. And then you can't let anybody in editorial, and nobody in editorial who's worth his salt would ever ask you to do this anyway. Nobody would say that you have to do it this way rather than the way you want to do it. That's not how editing works. It's your book, you get to decide. So I got to decide, and they said, well, it's a big pain in the ass, but we're going to let you have it. Thank you very much. And that's how it ended, with the way that I wrote it ultimately, not the way I wrote it the first time. Mm. The only lesson that there is in that little anecdote is to don't ever feel you have to do things different from how you want to do them.
Right.
It's your book. That's what authorship is.
Right. Your name is on it.
Yeah.
It's bigger than the publisher's name.
Well, it's at least it's the one you'll remember.
I mean bigger
as in size. I don't mean like the name is bigger. The Knopf is tiny, and the name.
Yeah.
At any rate.
It's the lady over here.
Take one more.
One more, thanks.
Hi.
Hello.
I'm in an undergrad program, so we just talk about, like, what is this story about? What is this story about? It's just the constant question. But the question we don't get to ask you guys is where it sprang from. So I was wondering if there's any pieces of writing that you've produced that have felt emotionally imperative because of a life encounter or a world event or anything like that, like you wrote it because you had to write it.
Mm.
They all feel like that.
Kind of, I think. That's probably true.
I mean, you don't write casually, not really. If you're writing about something that you're not really inspired by, if you're not engaged with, or something you don't really know that much about, it's kind of off to one side of the center of you and your mind and what you know and what you've just observed or what you're interested in. That will just be a lame piece of writing. It's gonna have to have some urgency and have to come from something that just kind of shook you up a little bit. It's kind of a disturbance. It's kind of a psychic injury, but it's also a piece of inspiration, and you explore it. I think. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I do. I mean, the last thing you want to do is shy away from something large. I remember one time I was living in Missoula. Christina and I were living in Missoula. And we lived in a valley, a little narrow valley called the Rattlesnake Valley, and. It was a rattlesnake creek in the middle. It was a very high, steep valley on both sides. And hills on both sides. And I was standing on the deck of my house, looking across the watershed to the other side of the watershed. And the other side of the watershed, it was on fire, and it was just completely ablaze. And I was thinking to myself, oh shit! I thought, if the wind changes, I'm done here. All that has to happen is just for a slight alteration in the wind, and all these sparks are going to come over to my house and burn my house down and everything else with it. And I thought, I have to write about this. So you don't ever want to, at least in my set of values, you don't ever want to run away from large issues, because they will give you the opportunity to say something about a subject that readers care about. Because if you recognize it as a large issue, and that's one of the things about being a novelist or a story writer, you have to believe that the things that you care about are probably also the things that other human beings care about. It's the basically empathetic impulse.
It's a great leap of faith that you, I mean, and that's the faith that the leap of faith that the writer takes, that I'm interested in this, so some other people must be. And you don't know for sure, but it turns out you're usually correct that some other people are.
It doesn't hurt to be to think of yourself as an ordinary soul, and that you have much in common with everybody else whom you're writing for.
Thank you both.